الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعين به ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الخلق أجمعين سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيب رب العالمين سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين اللهم اجمعنا معهم في عليين بعد يوم القيامة من غير سابقة عذاب ولا حساب آمين يا رب العالمين. Dear brothers and sisters, today's khutbah has a very important topic, which is the reality of dunya, حقيقة الدنيا, the reality of life. And I believe that every now and then, at least every week during Jum'ah, we have to reset the program of our mindset towards our life. Not only ourselves as Muslim adults, also our families and children. Why? Because life takes us in a wave of ups and downs, economical, political, social, day and day, busy at work, in streets, eating, having fun, dealing with difficulties, and that takes us away from sitting between ourselves and resetting and pre-programming and checking where are we right now, why are we here, and where are we going from here. And I chose to the topic of the reality of dunya and life because most of people on earth are striving to find a good life, to live in a comfortable way, prosperity, health, which is okay, but it becomes a goal, not a tool. When you are too much involved in the daily life, this daily life, this success, the material success becomes the reason you live for. And this is very dangerous. This is very, very dangerous. If we ask any of us, you know, just a sudden, without preparing, what do you do daily? What are your plans? Immediately, the mindset goes, my plans, inshallah, I'll finish my college degree, and then I'll find a job, then find a wife, and then inshallah have a business and then become rich and do this. Immediately, when you just catch someone in a sudden and you ask them a question, they will think you're asking about the daily dunya goals. But this is not what we are created for. Brothers and sisters, Allah created this dunya to be a mamar, وليس مستقر, a path, a journey, not a destination. A tool to reach to the destination. And when the dunya, when the people of dunya started working against this plan, the real happiness, no one really achieved. No one really achieved. And everybody is pressured, is stressed. Why am I getting sick? Why am I getting old? Why my son is not listening to me? Why me and my wife were struggling? Why and why? If we go back to square one and reset our mindset to why this dunya is the way it is, we will not be asking this why too much. We're just gonna deal with it, manage it, and continue, you know, the journey the way Allah wants us to do. And to understand any matter, the linguistic part is so important, something that our children may not be so much well equipped with. Just the word dunya, brothers and sisters, dunya, it's an Arabic term. What's the opposite? Ulya. Dunya, ulya. So everything in this dunya, in this life, is low in status, is not so important. The dunya, it's gonna vanish. Everything that will vanish, everything that has an expiry date, it is not compared to something that has no expiry date. So just by analyzing the term, dunya is very low in the status in the eyes of Allah Azza wa Jal. And as the meaning of the hadith, that if Allah Azza wa Jal sees dunya of any real value, He will not give the unbelievers even a sip of water. Why would Allah give a gift for the non-believers of Allah, those who work against the will of Allah, any gift, any ni'mah, any even water? But because the dunya, it doesn't matter for itself. It is a test. And let's look at the Quran saying in the famous surah that we all read almost daily, Surah Al-Mulk. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم تبارك الذي بيده الملك وهو على كل شيء قدير الذي خلق الموت والحياة ليبلوكم أيكم أحسن عملا وهو العزيز الغفور. Allah created death and life. And by the way, the ulama said here, why did Allah mention death first? الذي خلق الموت والحياة. The normal sequence of mindset of humans, maybe if someone will write an essay, he will write that Allah created life and death. And that's normal because you live and then you die. But Allah here mentioned death first. So He will shock our hearing and we should analyze that death is true. Death is the only fact that nobody can deny. Whether someone is atheist, someone is religious, Muslim, Christian, Jewish, wherever you are, death is a reality. So when Allah reminds us, death and life has been created. Why? لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. So the reality of life, it is a test. And this test is being designed so we will know, Allah will know, and we will know what are our choices to choose from passing this test. Are we going to survive? Are we going to actually apply the wisdom of Allah Azza wa Jalla in our lives and continue the journey knowing that we are on a trip? Imagine that someone traveling, how much back baggage he will take for the trip? You will take some food, a couple of bananas. You know, if your trip is 10 hours, 12 hours, driving to States or to Ottawa or whatever, you're going to only take what is enough for you. But if you see someone is taking so much food, so much clothes just for that trip, not for the staying part, so much, you know, a couple of extra gas tanks, you're going to look at him in a weird way. What are you doing with your life, brother? Like, this is just a short trip. You would rather plan, and you're going to ask this brother or sister, in Ottawa, did you book a hotel if you stay a couple of days? Oh, no, not yet. Did you buy a furniture for your new house, the one that you're moving to? Oh, no, really, I forgot. I mean, I might do it when I reach there. No. So it's so common sense that we have to plan for the destination much more than we plan for the trip. And this is something we need to analyze and teach it to our children. What happens in the Western countries where we teach our children to pray and fast, and inshallah everybody will fast Ashura next Tuesday, which is the 16th, because you know Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said we celebrate Ashura the day that Allah have made Musa alayhi salam survive from Pharaoh and the army of Pharaoh. So we celebrate by fasting, and there's a huge reward into this. Don't forget, please, to fast on Tuesday. So we teach our children the ibadat, but sometimes we forget to make their mindset around the living, like this matter. Simple matter, but very, very important. And that we live, son, daughter, we don't live just for living. We don't just live to eat and sleep and have houses and businesses. We are in a journey. And when you do this, what will happen? You will be able to deal with the challenges on the road. And again, the simple analysis of going to Ottawa. If you were, you know, if there was a closure somewhere or an accident, may Allah forbid it happens to any of us, on the way and there was a delay. Yes, you will be a little bit pressured, but anyway, you're expecting this to happen. When your car ran out of gas and you call CA&A to come because you forgot to fill up, it happens. When someone vomits and you need to stop and you know take care of them and buy some medicine for their vomiting because they had drowsiness, it happens. We are going to smartly deal with the challenges that happens on the road. Now, this is life. But if I put life, dunya life, as my goal, I will not be able to deal with the challenges, and I'm going to hate myself in every position that I'm put under a test or under a hardship, especially our children. Why this happened? Why that happened? So let us also serve through the other ayat, beautiful ayat. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم إنما أموالكم وأولادكم فتنة والله عنده أجر عظيم. This is another mindset that we have to deal with dunya. The first mindset that we need to understand that dunya is just a journey and any challenge is part of the test. The other challenge is the ni'mah that Allah gave us. It is also a test. And it is a bigger test. That Allah tests us with good and evil, with ni'mah and hardship. And what is the best ni'mah that we all want to enjoy? أموالكم وأولادكم. Who doesn't love money? Who doesn't love children? It's all, it's in our genes. So subhanAllah, even the more money you have, the more children you have, actually the bigger is that your test is. If our mindset about dunya will be correct, we will, yes, be happy with more money, halal money, and more children, but we have to be responsible. The weight we carry on our shoulders is bigger, and the accountability is bigger. Simple. I'm trying to simplify it so we can, I know we all know this, it's a reminder, but we want to help each other how we can talk to our kids about this. It's so simple. If you are, Yawm al-Qiyamah, you come in front of Allah Azza wa Jal with one child and only, you know, your income was, you're a farmer, so your produce, you sell it and you buy food and then what is your accountability compared to someone who has billions of dollars, MashaAllah, huge corporations, thousands of employees, 5 or 10 children, what is their accountability? And a simple example, the accountant. If you are an accountant and you're doing the accounting, the taxation for that farmer who have one child and one small farm, you're going to finish it in 5 minutes. But the accountant in dunya will take months before the due date of the year to finish the accounting of that rich man. So yes, the children and money is a huge ni'mah, great ni'mah. We thank Allah for it, but it comes with a lot of challenge. And continuing with the ayat, إِنَّمَا أَمْوَالُكُمْ وَأَوْلَادُكُمْ فِتْنَةً. Fitna, it's a test, it's a challenge. وَاللَّهُ عِنْدَهُ أَجْرٌ عَظِيمٌ. This is the mindset we are talking about today. It's so simple yet so critical. Allah has the best of reward. Allah has the عظيم reward. When Allah says it's عظيم, it's humongous, it's huge, it's big. Allah didn't specify how big. And if you want to know the value of anything, you look at the value of the one who gives it or promised you with it. If your colleague promised you a gift, you would expect a watch, $200-$300. If your manager promised you a gift, you would expect a raise in your salary from 50 to maybe 60,000 a year. If the owner of the company promised you a reward, you would expect a bigger. If the president or the prime minister promised you a reward, you expect bigger. When Allah promised you a reward, that is unlimited expectation. So this should be our goal, to please our Lord, to correct our mindset, to sit with ourselves and our families every week at least and talk about what happened and how much of that what happened is towards dunya, the vanishable reality, and how much of that effort and time have we have put towards our destination, which is al-akhirah. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم فيا فوز المستغفرين فاستغفر الله. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين أما بعد. We'll continue with the same ayat. إنما أموالكم وأولادكم فتنة والله عنده أجر عظيم. So what should we do? فاتقوا الله ما استطعتم واسمعوا وأطيعوا وأنفقوا خيرا لأنفسكم ومن يوق شح نفسه فأولئك هم المفلحون. What do we want? We want فلاح. فلاح means نجاح, means success, means prosperity. This is our target. Allah knows it and Allah will give it to us. But if we do what? فاتقوا الله ما استطعتم. Fear Allah. Obey Allah as much as you can. واسمعوا وأطيعوا. Listen and obey. Don't discuss with Allah why this and that. Obey. Trust Allah Azza wa Jalla. Trust His Prophet. Trust Sharia. It is for you, not against you. This is what we have to tell our children. Alhamdulillah, I'm not against discussing why and how, but it is important to put in our families that when the order comes from your Lord, you have to trust your Lord. Not everything is put on the table for discussion. Example, our great young sisters, why hijab? They have all the right to ask, but at the same time, they have to know the source of the order is Allah. So whether at that age it made total sense to them or it didn't, they still have to obey. And Allah will help them through the journey of hijab to understand more, grasp more, and be proud of it. And just for the hijab, I have a small example. Alhamdulillah, I keep on saying this to the children when we are with them, especially the teenager, that boys should be jealous from girls because girls have hijab. Now, what we hear day in and day out, that girls say, it's too hot, why I have to wear all these clothing, and I sweat, and I can't swim in lighter clothes, and I can't do this and that. Yes, there is a challenge, of course. But imagine when you understand the mindset and talk to them this way. Simple example. I tell them, if you know the value of hijab, the whole, all men and boys will feel so jealous and will feel that they are less fortunate, and of course they are not, but they will feel less fortunate than women because of that. Why? I tell the boys and the girls, in a simple language, if both of you are walking in the street, doing actually nothing, you're not doing tasbih, you're not doing hamd, you're not actually doing something wrong. So, in a simple formula, you're not gaining sayyat or hasanat. Let's say, although there is always, if you're going to do good, you're gaining hasanat. But I'm just talking to children in a way they understand. So you're doing nothing except walking in the street. So you're not doing good or not evil. I said, guess what? You as a boy, you're not gaining hasanat. She as a girl with hijab, gaining hasanat. Because she is living an act of worship. She is gaining hasanat for two main reasons. Not only, but two main reasons. One, she is doing ibadah. You're not doing ibadah. By wearing hijab, because Allah said so, that's an act of ibadah. And any ibadah has unlimited hasanat, unlimited ajr. Second, she is doing da'wah, you are not. For a boy or a man to do da'wah, you have to actually talk to people. You have to introduce Islam to people. You have to give them a Quran. You have to discuss with them. You have to invite them to conferences. For girls to do da'wah, they can do that as well. But they do da'wah by just wearing hijab. Because I give them simple example. If you as a girl walking in a street where, or in a village or near the Amish or traveling, and you went through people that they've never heard about Islam and they've never seen a hijabi, are these people available? Of course. Yes, so many. Or some of them know the solitaire. So you remind them by just your looks that there is Islam. And it did happen. It did happen, wallahi, many times. But just because someone who never knew about Islam saw a hijabi woman walking and they wondered, what is this attire that lady is wearing? Whether they ask the lady or they don't, they go to Mr. Google and search. Why some women wear veil or wear something on their head? Who are they and what it is? What's the purpose? And subhanAllah, when Allah wants to open the heart of a person, that just that girl walking in the street made someone interested to learn about the reason of hijab, and eventually a lot of them become Muslims. So I tell boys, after knowing that, your sister, the hijabi sister, she's in an act of ibadah with all hasanat showering her. Second, she's doing da'wah and you're not. You're picking your nose or you're just scratching your back or just wondering what to do tomorrow with your friends. And now that what makes them realize, oh yes, wallahi, it makes sense. Now, when we fix our mindset, the challenges, the sweat that comes with hijab, the limitation of movement or games or interacting with certain, you know, fun is being challenged or limited, the girls will be proud of doing that. And they will answer any question they want. I'm here, I'm obeying Allah Azza wa Jalla, and I believe in Him. So, brothers and sisters, the title of the khutbah is The Reality of Life. Life is a journey, not a destination. Life has a lot of challenges. It is a test. And we are tested not just by evil, by good. And the test of good is bigger than evil. Because when we are rich or we have no problems, we get so busy, more busy to remember Allah. Sometimes sickness, poorness, challenges will make you closer to Allah. Allah purifies us if we are patient. And I'll end up with a very beautiful say that is being said that Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu have said it. I'm not sure, I didn't check it, but it could be that we want to live like Ali ibn Abi Talib in this beautiful last couple of words. Please pay attention. It's a very high status. Whenever something good comes to him, whether he won a war or a gift comes or someone wants to invite him somewhere or give him beautiful clothes, he talks to himself, he talks to the dunya and he says, يا دنيا يا دنيا غري غيري طلقتك ثلاثا لا رجعة بعدها. He speaks to dunya saying, oh you dunya, dunya the very low in status and in value, don't try to seduce me, don't try to overwhelm me, don't try to make me happy with you. I have divorced you 3 times. You know in Islam when you divorce 3 times, 3 times, whether in one sitting or in 3 settings, there are, it means it's a full divorce, final. There's no coming back. So Ali ibn Abi Talib, radiallahu anhu, the husband of Fatima al-Zahra, the daughter of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he has a lot of hikmah and wisdom, telling dunya that don't try hard. Whether you open all doors of goodness or all doors of evil, I have divorced you 3. Don't, لا رجعة بعدها, no return after it. Some of the Sahaba have reached to a level that sadness, challenges and good are equal. Some of the Sahaba said that if I enter Jannah now, if I know that Jannah is there now, I'm not gonna do any different. I'm not gonna be extremely sad of what happened in dunya because I was living in Jannah while I'm in dunya. I enjoy ibadah as if I am in Jannah. Brothers and sisters, this psychological mindset, this philosophical way of looking at things, which should help us get out from the materialistic world, from the capitalism. Nowadays we live very dry concepts. It's all about money, food, clothes, brands. Please, today, go out with one message. Dunya is not ulya. Dunya is a road, not a destination. And the ni'mah, any challenges, we can face it with sabr and we manage it with qala Allah, qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In deen, it's all our solutions. Please don't forget to fast Ashura. Don't forget to support the masjid outside. They need at least 350,000 to complete their project, sister area renovation. It's part of the ataa wa anfiqu fi sabilillah. Don't forget to sit with your families and discuss the mindset of what is the reality of dunya. May Allah bless you all. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم. اللهم اغفر لنا وارحمنا. اللهم اغفر لنا وارحمنا. اللهم اغفر لنا وارحمنا. اللهم اغفر لنا فوق الأرض وتحت الأرض ويوم العرض عليك. اللهم آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. اللهم اغفر لنا ولوالدينا ولأبنائنا وبناتنا ولإخواننا وأخواتنا ولأعمامنا وأخوالنا وخالاتنا وعماتنا ولكل من يحبه ويحبوننا ولمدرسينا وأساتذتنا وأساتذتنا ومشايخنا ولمن القائمون على هذا المسجد وعلى المتبرعين له والمصلين فيه. اللهم ارحمنا رحمة واسعة تسعنا في الدنيا والآخرة. اللهم لا تقبضنا إلا وأنت راض عنا. اللهم لا تقبضنا إلا وأنت راض عنا. اللهم ارفع الغمة عن الأمة. اللهم حرر المسجد الأقصى. اللهم حرر المسجد الأقصى وارزقنا صلاة فيه قبل الممات محررا يا رب العالمين. اللهم انقذ المستضعفين في غزة وفي فلسطين وفي كل العالم الذي نعيش فيه. اللهم انقذهم مما هم فيه. اللهم اكسوا عريانهم وأطعم جائعهم واشفي مرضاهم وأخرج أسراءهم وحرر أوطانهم. آمين يا رب العالمين. اللهم اغفر لنا تقصيرنا في حقهم واجعلنا ممن تستعمله في خدمة الدين وخدمة الدعوة. آمين رب العالمين. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. وأنت يا أخي أقم الصلاة. الله أكبر الله أكبر.